Hello everyone, this video is going to be a bit different from the usual. Today we are going to see a super quick tutorial to get up and running with SketchUp, the very well known to be ultra easy to use 3D modeling tool aimed at architectural design. I think SketchUp complements perfectly Inkscape, especially at the moment of making accurate 3D environments like this room. Learning the basics of SketchUp opens up a million possibilities at the moment of using it together with Inkscape, as a way to supply one of the main weaknesses of vector modeling, which is 3D drawing. If you need to draw an accurate room in perspective or a building or anything like that, with SketchUp you can really quickly and easily make the base and then send it to Inkscape to finish it up. So learning SketchUp is a great idea for anyone who uses Inkscape for illustrations. As an example, I made this isometric bedroom where I started the illustration with the SketchUp and ended up tracing it with Inkscape. I also recorded all of the process and made a step-by-step real-time tutorial on modeling and tracing it and everything as an extra. If you're interested in checking that mini course, the link is in the description. With that out of the way, let's get to learn SketchUp. So here I am in the SketchUp free main page. I'll leave a link in the resources, but I got here by googling SketchUp free. Oddly enough, I couldn't find the free access through the main SketchUp Trimble page. On that page, it leads you to the trial version of the desktop application. Anyway, sadly, Trimble no longer offers a free desktop version of SketchUp, so you have to use the free web version, which is annoying to use, I know, because it requires online connectivity and sometimes it loads very slowly, but at least you have most of the important functionality working flawlessly. So, yep, you need to make a Trimble account or log in with Google or other account. Once that you log in into the app, you can hit Create New to start a new document. And this is SketchUp. Here at the sides, you have the three axes to help you navigate and move around. And then you have this little icon of a person, which is there to help you indicate the sizes and proportions. Let's talk about navigation. You orbit around the center by using the middle mouse button. And you pan around by holding Shift while holding the middle mouse button. You can zoom in and zoom out by using the wheel. You can also use the tools in the toolbar at the side to orbit, pan, and zoom in. Some of these tools are going to be important later on for different reasons. The true power and genius of SketchUp is its simplicity. You can model almost anything using only two tools, a shape tool, which allows you to draw a shape on any plane, and the push-pull tool, which allows you to give it depth by extruding that shape. And that's the basic workflow of almost any model in SketchUp. You can access the tools here on the toolbar at the left, but these are not all the tools you have available. If you click on the little dots, you see that you have way more. You can move the tools from the toolbar to this menu and the other way around if you want. But I recommend you to memorize the shortcuts. In any case, the three tools used last that are not on the toolbar will be shown here after the divider. Okay, let's start introducing the different shape tools. And arguably the most important and the one you'll be using the most is the rectangle tool, shortcut R. This lets you create a rectangle of any size. Take a look at the little diagonal line if you want to make a square rectangle. Now to demonstrate how to work on SketchUp, I'll be using the push-pull tool to push this plane up. The shortcut is P. Whenever you hover over the rectangle, you see these blue dots indicating that you can use the tool on that plane. Just click and push as much as you want. If you're familiar with other 3D modeling programs, you'll notice that the push-pull tool works just like an extrude operation, with one important difference. When you use the push-pull tool on an already extruded area, it won't extrude it again. Instead, it will just adjust the planes. And this allows you to redimension any plane without the need to use any other tool, which is very intuitive and easy to use. The next shape tool you'll be using the most is the circle tool, shortcut C. This lets you make circles, great for making pillars and things like that. By the way, if you look at the bottom of the screen, you'll notice that you get a text prompt along with an input. A few other tools have some extra options like this. For the circle tool, by using Ctrl plus and minus, you can change the amount of sides the circle has. Like with all polygonal modeling, there is no such thing as a curve here. All curves are made of tiny sides, and if the shape is made of two little sides, you'll start to notice them, which can be or not what you're after. In any case, if you want to make something circular and smooth, keep in mind this input and give it a nice big number. The circle tool works as you would expect it with the push-pull tool, with the main difference that you cannot change the circumference with it. This is a great moment to also demonstrate one extremely common and useful feature of the push-pull tool, and that is to push and pull to the length of an already existing plane. When you're using it, you can move the pointer towards another plane and you'll see this dotted line with a dot in the end, indicating that it will stay to the same distance than that plane. This is a very useful and common thing to do when you're modeling. For the next tools, we need to talk about another really important feature of modeling in SketchUp, and that is the fact that all shape tools work on any surface. Here's an example, I can make a rectangle and pull it up, and now both the rectangle tool and the circle tool work on any of the planes. Now if I want, I can use the push-pull tool to extrude a surface, and I can repeat this indefinitely on any new surface created, but only on the flat planes. I cannot draw the shapes on the curved side of a circle tool extrusion. But what happens if I intersect two shapes on a surface like this? Well, another really useful feature shows up. If you switch to the push-pull tool, you'll notice that the blue dots indicating where I can use it, they stay to the closed areas created by the intersection of the planes. This is extremely useful because I can design the different areas I want to extrude by purposefully intersecting shapes. And here's where the next tool comes to be useful. The line tool, shortcut L, allows you to make a line on a surface. You can make it in any direction and angle, but very usefully, it snaps at the axis angles easily. In combination with what we just saw, it further allows you to sculpt a plane to later on extrude it. And those were the basic tools for modeling you need to know. There are other tools, but those are used less frequently, and you should have no problem learning them on the spot. Okay, we've taken a look at the shape and push and pull tools, and you can go pretty far with this alone, but there are other set of tools that complement that and allows you to fully make any type of 3D architectural model, the select tool and the movement tools. Then there are other features that are related, such as the grouping options, which we'll see in a minute here. I've noticed that because of the way the modeling tools are implemented in SketchUp, unlike with other 3D modeling applications, the transformation tools seem more useful for handling groups than for modeling. But we'll see more about that later. Let's talk about the select tool, shortcut space. This tool lets you select any line or side. You can use it with other operations such as delete or move. You'll notice the line or side will get the blue dots to show it selected. If you hold shift, you can select multiple lines or sides. If you delete a side using the delete shortcut, this side will be left empty. If you delete a line, depending on if it's been used on an extrusion or not, it will do different things. The most common use for this tool is to clean up and sculpt out the divisions made on a surface, so you can get the exact shape you want to use with the push-pull tool. The other important use is to select lines and sides and also groups, so you can adjust them with the transformation tools. These tools will let you move, rotate, and scale the selected line or sides or groups. I found that in SketchUp, since you have so many other tools to control the geometry, these tools are more useful with groups than with the geometry, but we'll see that in a minute. The Move tool allows you to move a line or side in any direction. Shortcut is M. Just pick the Move tool and select the thing you want to move. You'll see these blue dots indicating what's going to be selected. If you want to move multiple sides or lines at the same time, you have to select them first with the Selection tool, holding Shift, and then switch to the Move tool. If you pay attention at the bottom of the app, you'll notice a hint that lets you know you can lock the directions using the arrow keys, which can be important when you want to be accurate. The rotation tool works similarly to the move tool, but now you'll see this protractor widget that's there to help you handle the rotations better. If you hover over the rectangle, you'll notice how it changes color according to the side, with the y-axis being blue, the z-axis being green, and the x-axis being red, matching the color of the line of the axis. To rotate, you'll need to click once to establish the plane and rotation point, and a second time to establish the pivot point and start rotating. But here's the problem. You'll notice that the protractor widget automatically aligns with the normals of the plane. If you want to, say, rotate this plane not along the y-axis, but rather along the z or x-axis, then you can't. The solution is in the hint at the bottom of the app again. Here you'll see that you can use the arrow keys to switch between the three rotation axes. This is also important to rotate single planes or a single line in the right way you want it. The final transformation tool is the scale tool. This time you won't be able to scale lines, only sides. When you click on a side, you'll get this selection with little green cubes. Depending on which cube you grab, you'll scale toward that direction, just like in Inkscape. And just like in Inkscape, you can also scale from the center using Ctrl and scale uniformly using Shift. If you use the selection tool to select more than one side or an inclined plane, you'll see the full version of this widget. This contains all possible scaling points, including the ones from the center. This functions exactly as you would expect it. They scale towards the direction of each cube. The same shortcuts still apply. I mentioned earlier that these transformation tools are less useful at the moment of actually modeling because of the tools SketchUp has, and that they are more useful for handling groups. In SketchUp, groups lets you group up the geometry so you can work on it as if it was one separated object. One thing you probably noticed if you've worked for a while in SketchUp is that even if you model it in separated islands, if you happen to overlap the models, then they'll automatically merge into a single object. Groups are meant to help you to keep the models as separate and individual units. That's why they are integral to the way SketchUp works. Using groups is really easy. Once you made your object, switch to the selection tool and select everything you want to group. Left-click and go to Make Group. If you use any of the shape tools, you'll notice that you can still interact with the surfaces and use them to make new shapes, but you won't be able to affect the geometry inside of the group. That means it won't merge with it. Now you can only make transformations on the entire group at once. You can still edit it if you want. All you have to do is to double-click to enter the group, and this will show a dotted cube indicating that you are inside of a group. Now you can add, delete, and transform the geometry as if it wasn't grouped at all. Once you're done, double-click anywhere on the canvas to leave the group. If you don't need a group anymore, you can always ungroup it by left-clicking and hitting Explode. Like I said in SketchUp, groups are more of a necessity rather than a convenience, so remember to group everything that's supposed to be separated. And that was about everything you'll need to know about SketchUp to get up and running. Everything else is either not essential or not part of the modeling. Of course, there are a ton of useful features, but those are more specific and we'll deal with that at the moment we'll need it. Don't forget to like and subscribe, and check out the isometric mini course if that's something that interests you. Link in the description. So that was it for this week. Have a great day. Bye.